Hi guys, welcome back. I'm Ian Laspina, and today we're going to talk about soft kit. Hey guys, before we even get started today, I want to draw your attention to another channel that I really think is an excellent channel with excellent content, but gets a lot less attention than it deserves and has a lot less subscribers than it really should. And that is I Am Shad. I Am Shad is an excellent channel by a gentleman named Shad Brooks in Australia who does really in-depth, really thought-provoking content, creates content on swords, various historical topics, gaming, and a lot of really interesting philosophical topics that I think are kind of in line with what my audience likes. So I really think that you guys would be served well by also checking him out so that you can see the kind of content that he puts out. I really recommend it. All right, so what I want to talk about today is soft kit, or basically the regular clothes that a person would be wearing when they're not in armor. If you think about it, this is kind of one of the areas that really gets neglected by people, especially people who are new and really focused on the martial aspect of reenactment, the martial garments, armor, weapons, and things like that. So, a person wasn't in armor all the time. You obviously had to wear regular clothes at some point in your life as well. And I would go so far as to say that you spent a lot more time in regular clothes than you did in actual harness. Even from a reenactment standpoint, when you're at a particularly long event, you know, you're not gonna spend 15, 16, 24 hours a day in armor. You wear armor when you need to wear armor, when you're talking to guests about armor. And then you wear your soft kit. So what I end up seeing a lot is people get so focused on wearing armor and they end up with this really fancy harness, and then they end up dressing like a peasant when they're not in their harness. And that doesn't really make sense from the reenactment standpoint of the social status that you're trying to portray. Social status is a huge deal in the late Middle Ages. And the people who are wearing well-fitted, fancy, nice harness are not people who cannot afford to dress well. It's kind of the myth of the poor knight, especially in the late medieval. Of course, there are examples of people with knighthoods who weren't wealthy, but in general, when you're talking about the knightly class, you're kind of talking about the 1% of the Middle Ages. And then it's a contradiction in terms to kind of say, you know, I have really fancy harness, but I don't have the clothes to kind of support that same impression of social status. The nice thing about soft kit is that a lot of it can be done by yourself, whereas armor smithing is a very specific, very highly skilled profession. I started sewing a couple years ago, and 90% of the stuff that I'm wearing right now is stuff that I made myself. So it can be done by novices. I'm not a historical clothing expert. I'm not an armor expert either. But I know a lot more about armor and weapons than I do about clothing construction, but I know enough to kind of get by. And I have the enough skill to be able to, make the clothing that would be required for the level of reenactment that I do. So if this is something that you find interesting, because it's something that I find interesting, if you enjoy this kind of content, what I'd like to do is go into more detail on the specifics of clothing, how to line a doublet, how to finish seams, how to make turn shoes, how to think about things like bag hats or hoods or chaperones, stuff like that, wool versus linen. These are all things that are not only important to a reenactor, but also interesting, I think, from the standpoint of somebody with only an academic interest in the Middle Ages. So what I'm going to do today is go over my soft kit in a quick general overview of the different types of garments that I would normally wear at an event or during some sort of reenactment or public educational demonstration, what have you. And if you enjoy it, please let me know in the comments below, and in the future we can revisit a lot of these things in more detail than what I give you today. Okay, so for the very base layer, I've got a basic linen undershirt on, linen braise, wool hosen, and then shoes and garters, which I'll show in a minute. The shirt is pretty self-explanatory, a basic linen shirt. The braise. So braise, and if you guys find this interesting, we can do an individual video on that. But the braise changed dramatically through the 14th and then into the 15th and then later in the 15th century. They basically transformed from really loose boxers into very tight-fitting briefs. And then there are a million different ways to suspend hosen. I'm experimenting with one of those methods currently that is contemporary to this time, at least there's some evidence for it, and that is the use of an integral braise girdle or a belt in the casing of the braise themselves with points to go to the hosen. Another very common method around the turn of the 14th, 15th century is to point the braise directly to the doublet. And again, we can look at all that stuff more in detail in a future video if you find it interesting. The hosen I'm wearing are wool, and in this case, I'm wearing split hosen. So if you remember back to the arming garments video, I was wearing single point hosen, which are a little bit outdated by the time period that I usually do. I just typically wear them under armor because I have a bunch of pairs of them and they're old and I don't care that they get destroyed by armor. The difference between these hose and the hose that I was wearing then is that they're pointed in multiple places to provide higher and more coverage. So if I turn around, you can see that it gives you a lot more coverage in the back than single point chausses. And if they were pointed tightly, you see that's what it would normally look like. I have the rear points loose so that it facilitates this motion. And we see that in contemporary artwork as well, where people actually just leave the back points untied and the back of the split hosen are just kind of hanging there, usually in scenes of people doing work and things like that where they need to have full freedom of their legs. On the lower leg, I've got a pair of garters. The garters were worn by men and women. They hold the lower part of the hosen nice and tight and flush against the lower leg, and they also facilitate things like in hot weather when you want to turn your hosen into shorts, which we can, again, if this is interesting to you, we can look at that as well in its own video. And then on my feet, this is a very simple pair of turn shoes that I made myself. This is like the absolute most basic turn shoe construction. These don't have a rand or anything in them, if you're familiar with that, and there's really no edge finishing. When I make myself a new pair of turn shoes, now that I have several pairs under my belt, I will do some of the more advanced construction techniques like adding a rand in the seam, proper edge finishing, heel stiffener, and then these just are side lacing on the inside of the foot. Okay, so the next garment that I'm going to put on is going to be a kind of turn of the 14th, 15th century style wool doublet. It is lined in basic white linen. And you'll notice that it has about a million buttons on it, and that was pretty common. Styling. You'll see different variations on that. Very commonly you'll see buttons here on the forearm to make this very tight. Different types of buttons. I'm using metal buttons. You'll see what are called self-fabric buttons, where it's little balls of fabric made from the same material as the rest of the garment that are used as buttons in place of metal buttons. Very, very common. And you'll notice that this one has kind of departed from the 14th century. As you move into the 15th century, the style of the really puffy chest in a doublet starts to get a lot less exaggerated. So this one is a lot more form-fitted, and I'll go ahead and button it. All right, so the doublet's on, and you can see when I turn around, it gives you pretty good coverage. You don't see your braise hanging out, which is kind of a reenactorism, especially for gentry class to have that diaper look of their braise hanging out of their clothing. And then I would belt this, and I'm just going to be wearing a simple belt with a purse that I made. And I would belt this at about the natural waist. You'll notice that the belt has a buckle. Ring belts like you see at Renaissance fairs and stuff like that are kind of a modern invention. It's not a historical type of belt. Some belts are long, some are not, but this particular one is, and you see that a lot in artwork where you basically just loop it down through itself and then belt it here, the natural waist, with the pouch, the purse accessible. All right, now of course, nobody is properly dressed until they have something worn on their head. One thing that's maybe kind of a reenactorism too, is that you see tons of people always wearing linen coifs, as if like everybody constantly wore a linen coif on their head no matter what they were doing, especially by this late in the medieval. You don't really see that very commonly in artwork. You usually see various other styles of headwear. In this case, I'm going to be showing you a very simple bag hat. It's literally a wool bag, and then you roll the brim you roll the opening to form a brim. And then the one that I'm wearing right now has a brooch on it to act as a hat jewel, which you see very commonly in artwork. So now I would be ready to go about my business. This is kind of a basic outfit. You notice that all the external layers are wool. Wool helps wick moisture away from you, so especially clothing that's well tailored, it wicks moisture away from you because that wool is very close to your body and it draws the moisture away, allows it to evaporate, keeps you cooler, believe it or not. And it's also an awesome water repellent. If the weather is particularly bad, then you can wear other outer layers, and I'll show you that. So this is a cloak, and again, if you guys find the construction interesting, we can talk about that more, but it's not just a simple half circle like a lot of people make them. There's a little bit of tailoring involved so that it fits properly. This is a kind of fashionable cloak for gentlemen of the turn of the 14th, 15th century, where it's a relatively short cloak and it's side fastening. So these are the self buttons that I was talking about. So these are just buttons made from this wool. So it would be worn like this so that the right arm is free, and you'll notice the left arm is not free. But in the event that you need to be able to use both hands, you can simply drape it over, and now I've got both hands free. And you can, it's not going to fall back over unless it's actually pretty hard to do because the wool kind of sticks to itself. It's wool on both sides. It's just lined with a thinner and different contrasting color wool. But having worn this in actual inclement weather, this is why you want wool. When it's raining, the wool basically, water beads off the wool, which is awesome. I've worn this in steady rain with this hat on, and I do not get wet underneath. Wool can retain a lot of moisture before it actually soaks all the way through, so it's really outstanding for that kind of thing. And it does keep you warm too. This is a very thick wool on the outside, and like I said, lined with a thinner wool. Wool comes in all different weights, so it's not like, it's kind of a modern myth that wool equals hot. That's just not true. Heavy, thick wool equals hot. Thin wools don't necessarily equal hot. And then if the weather is particularly bad, I could wear something called pattens. So these are a pair of my patents based on a 14th century example. There are a million different styles of patents as well. So again, if this is something you find interesting, we can talk about those more in depth. But these are designed to protect your shoes in bad weather. So to put them on, you simply, this particular style just slips on. These don't have any hinges or anything like that. There are some that are like that. But now you can see I've elevated my foot, and now if I'm walking through mud, water, wet terrain, things like that, the patents take the brunt of that kind of muck and all that stuff, keeping my feet dry and out of the water. All right, and then if you really want to look like Mr. Fancy Pants, you would wear a fancy gown. So this is a silk brocade gown. Please forgive its appearance. Believe it or not, getting dressed, especially in fancy stuff, is not a one-man job. So you would actually have somebody whose job it was to aid you in arranging the folds on your gown. I can't do it myself, especially in the back. I just can't reach and arrange all the folds symmetrically. But that is something that would be done so that it looks exactly how you want it to look. And this is kind of an extravagant gown, excessive bag sleeves, things to demonstrate wealth. I'm wearing it right now with the plaque belt, but you could easily wear it with a simple belt as well. I just want to show you different combinations of things. If you wanted to fancy it up one other level, the next thing you would do would be either to line it or trim it in fur. I hope to trim it in fur one day, but I'm not about to line the whole thing in fur. This particular one is completely lined in just linen right now. And then again, to top it off, you see that I lost my headwear. I'm going to show you a different method of a different style of headwear. In this case, it's going to be a chaperone. So this is really just a hood with a lira pipe. And then the face opening is rolled to form a brim. And then you put the face opening on top of your head instead of going in through the bottom of the hood. And I have a hat jewel sewn onto this one. And then you take the lira pipe, arrange it in some fancy way, and voila, you have a chaperone so that you can look really fancy. Oh, and I forgot to mention, this is all worn over the doublet. So you can see the doublet is still on underneath the gown. All right, guys, thank you. If you found this useful and interesting, please leave that in the comments section below. A huge thank you to the people who have decided to help support the channel on Patreon. I very much appreciate it. I'm very grateful for that decision. For people who are unaware, I do have a Facebook page too, where I release a lot of photography information on events that I'll be attending and other interesting things that I think you guys might find enjoyable. So please consider following me on there as well. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel, share it with your friends, and we'll be back soon with another video. Thank you. Bye.